Alrighty, so my word was respiration. And in the book, it covers two things, respiration being the act of breathing, and therefore, two situations happen. One is where you are inhaling air that is cooler than your body, and therefore you lose heat by exhaling. You're pulling in cold air, it cools you down, and then you exhale warmed air, but this cools down what's going on in your body. The other problem is when you have when you're inhaling air that is warmer than your body. And what happens is you end up actually heating yourself up because of the exposure to the higher air. The situation I can relate to is since I come to Idaho, I have found out with a surprise that I don't handle dry cold air very well at all. Because what happens is I get very tight up here and then I get more mucus production. And it's been a challenge this past winter. My wife and I decided to go take a quick hike up to the top of Initial Point. And of course, being all snowy and messy, she's like, let's go right up. So yeah, we did. I got up to the top and I'm like, this was fun. I can't breathe. So that's my story.
Okay. Dusty.
Read my notes.
Get you all prepared.
Yes, I did misspell it.
I've got radiation. Radiation is the transfer of heat by radiant energy. Radiant energy is an invisible light that transfers heat. And my example for that is, if I turn on this space heater, it heats up. It heats up the immediate area, which is the radiant heat, comes in contact with your skin, and it warms your skin or your body. Vice versa, if you stand in a cold room or you stand outside, your body is always radiating heat, and you're not gaining any from the atmosphere or the environment, you're going to end up losing more than you're taking in, therefore lowering your body temperature.
And evaporation is the conversion of any liquid. This conversion, that process takes energy, and that energy will transfer heat in a way. So I guess the example would be sweating. So when you exercise, your body produces sweat, and the reason it does this is to cool your body down. When you produce the sweat evaporates off your skin. The energy required to do that then cools your skin. So then it cools your body.
Cool. Mr. Brown.
Mine is convection. And it is the transfer of heat through air circulation. So as air moves across to your body, it, or anything, it will lose heat that way. That's why wind chill factor is very important, because if you have exposed skin, you know, the ambient temperature might be, say, 10 degrees, but if you get a 30 mile an hour wind, it might be negative 10, so you're going to be prone to frostbite quicker.
Okay. Can I grab my notebook? What's in there? Yeah.
Okay, so mine was conduction, and it is the transfer of heat by direct contact. Example is if you touch a hot pan, the heat is transferred to your hand. I don't know.
What's another example?
If your hand's like warmer than ice, your hand could like stick to the ice because of the.
If your hand's warmer than anything, it feels cold to you and you transfer heat to it, right? Okay. Why is it important that you know about the different types of heat conduction?
You need to know possibly how the exposure is affecting them.
Okay. So. Let's take our example of you being in Death Valley. Okay. How is this method of heat conduction, respiration, how's that going to affect your exposure in Death Valley?
It's hot there, possibly during the day, so I'll be breathing in really hot air, which will then heat me up, or cold if it's
at night.
So.
Yep. Okay. And what about radiation?
You're standing in the hot sun, you're going to
cool it quickly.
Yeah, and not only is it coming from the sun, but it's coming off the sand too, right? It's radiating back up to you off the sand. That's why if you're in the water, a lot of times you'll get a sunburn on the top half of your body and not the bottom, because you got, you know, sun coming back up off the water. What about evaporation?
I can't sweat enough to evaporate or to cool me down, or I'm sweating so much then I'll get dehydrated.
Yeah, particularly in a place like Death Valley where it's so hot during the day, you're going to sweat so much that you're going to become dehydrated, and evaporation is going to stop being an option to cool you. And convection?
The air is really hot.
If there's not a breeze, you're not going to cool off as quick either.
Okay.
Or if you're standing in a very cold place and you're constantly being blown on with a cold wind, you want to try to find shelter to get out of that, because you'll lose heat otherwise.
Yeah, so let's talk about it in Death Valley, because let's talk about it during the day, okay, instead of in cold. How is convection going to cause more exposure for us?
It's blowing hot air onto me.
Quite likely during the day there, you're not going to feel cool or cold winds, right? You're going to have winds that are hotter than your own body temperature. So those winds are going to be taking heat away from you as well.
It's like standing on a dryer. It's also going to work in concert with the evaporation concept as well. So there's a synergy going on here.
Yeah. And what about conduction?
I will be touching the ground in some way, which is super hot. I mean, my feet, my hands, laying there.
Yeah. Okay. The rate and amount of heat loss or gain by the body can be modified in three ways. Okay? The first is to increase or decrease heat production. How do we increase heat production?
Shivering.
Your body shivers. Your muscles start to shiver. How else can we increase heat production?
Eating. Physical activity.
Pardon?
Physical activity.
Physical activity. Okay, so let's... an increase in heat production. That can be caused by shivering, physical activity,
put on more clothes.
So putting on more clothes isn't going to increase the heat production. What it's going to do is try and conserve the heat that you're already building. Okay? So, what else? What else are we going to do to increase our heat production?
Eating.
Helps. Yeah, eating. What does eating do?
Your metabolism now has something to work on, therefore you can, your metabolism can speed up to generate more heat as okay. it needs to.
What if we want to decrease heat production?
Sweating.
I didn't hear you.
Sweating. Stand still.
Panting.
Okay.
Dog, bro.
We're gonna sweat like dogs, is that what you're saying?
Don't work so hard.
Don't work so hard.
Lower your physical activity.
I'm gonna call it open mouth breathing instead of panting, okay?
Hydrating.
What?
Hydrating. Drink cold water.
Chief, you said something else that I didn't get written down.
That was 4 seconds ago. I can't remember that one.
Sweating, open mouth breathing.
Oh, well, not working so hard. Lower your physical.
Yeah, lower your physical activity. Right? If you're in a place where you're cold, go find some place to be warm. If you're in a place where you're too warm, go find some place to be cold. And then the last thing is to wear appropriate clothing for the environment. Always cold. Always. Doesn't matter where I'm at. I guess I can't say always, because sometimes in the summer, if I'm laying in the sun, I'm not cold. But those moments are few and far between. In the house in the summer, I'm cold. In the water in the summer, I'm cold. In my classroom, all year long, I'm cold. And so I always make sure that I have another jacket to go with me, because no matter what I'm wearing, at some point, I'm going to need the jacket. I need a jacket or a hoodie. I have a nice wide selection of hoodies, you know, because I need them fairly regularly. They go everywhere with me. All right. What is it called when the body, when your body temperature falls below 95 degrees?
Hypothermia.
Break that down into medical terms for me.
Low temperature.
Low and thermia has to do with cold, with temperatures.
Okay, it's a little bit more complicated than that, because therm is the root word. That's your prefix, okay? That's your root word. Then we have a suffix that goes along with it. So when we put those together, it means a specific term. And it does mean low temperature, but it actually means condition of low temperature. I don't know why the suffix, when you define it, the suffix comes before the prefix when it comes after in the word, but it's condition of low temperature. So it's not just having a low body temperature, it's everything that goes along with that low body temperature. Make sense? So what are some of the signs and symptoms of hypothermia?
Confusion.
Confusion is an early one, huh? I need to leave one. we have?
Blue lips and fingertips.
Okay, what else?
Loss of motor function.
Shivering.
We're going to see shivering fairly early on. When we get down to this point, we don't have shivering anymore. Okay, what else?
The body systems will start shutting down. Like you'll have a slower pulse, slower respirations. Unresponsive?
They become unresponsive. What else are we going to see?
Stiffness?
Pardon?
Stiffness, like their body will start becoming stiff.
Okay. Anything else? Yes? No?
It's coma. It's a late, 80 to 88 degrees, coma and apparent death after that.
Mm-hmm. So, one of the things that we can see or feel in a patient who is hypothermic is a change in the temperature of their skin. Their skin temperature is going to start decreasing. So we're going to start seeing a difference when it's like 90 to 95 degrees. That's mild hypothermia, right?
That's core body temperature.
Yeah. How do we check their skin temperature?
Capillary refill is going to disappear.
Capillary refill will disappear, but how do we check their skin temperature?
Feel it.
Back of your hand.
Feel it with what?
Back of your hand.
Where?
On their tummy.
Cheek. On their tummy. Why are we feeling their tummy? Because you just read it in the book?
Because it's the core of their body.
It's core body temperature.
Yeah. That area is the least likely to have a temperature change.
Unless you're exercising.
Okay, but they're not exercising. We're dealing with a hypothermic patient here. Okay, so that area of the body is the least likely to have a temperature change. Why?
Because it's where a lot of your blood is, and you're just the core of your body. I mean, your extremities are obviously going to start having the changes the quickest, and you store the most fat around your stomach as well, so that's pretty well insulated.
Okay. Why are we going to have the changes in our extremities early on?
Chief. Your body's going to start shunting blood from non-necessary organs to necessary organs such as heart, lungs, brain.
Right.
So if you start losing temperature in the gut, that means your body is shunting the blood away from that area to places where it needs to conserve more.
Right. So we're going to lose blood, or we're going to lose temperature in our extremities first, because our body is going to shunt the blood away from the exposure to the cold, which is at the surface of the skin, right? And it's going to want to keep the vital organs warm. So our vital organs are mostly in our core, and so it keeps the blood there as much as possible. So that's going to be why it's one of the last places for you to notice hypothermia happening. Now, if you look at your table 32-1, we have a table of hypothermia there, and it gives you the signs and symptoms at each different temperature, but those are all person-specific. If your normal body temperature runs at 99, you might start suffering from some of these signs of mild hypothermia when your body temperature gets to 96. So rather than counting on your patient's core temperature to tell you what's going on, you should learn the signs and symptoms of hypothermia so that you can kind of figure out what's going on with your patient regardless of what their temperature is. It's a pretty good idea, pretty good range, but it's not specific to every patient because every patient is different. What are local cold injuries?
Specific to a body part.
Okay, they're specific to a body part. So a lot of times, those are your digits, right? Your phalanges, your fingers and your toes that suffer from frostbite. Your fingers, your toes, your ears, your nose. Right? Those are the parts of your exposed body that often suffer from frostbite. And what is frostbite?
So the tissues are actually developing ice crystals in them.
Okay. Actually, before we go back very much further, as a person gets colder and colder and colder, their heart rate and their respiratory rate slow down until it could seem like they don't have one at all. So if you are in a position where you need to resuscitate a patient who's been or who is hypothermic, they're not dead until they're warm and dead. So you have to warm them up, do all the resuscitative measures that you can, and warm them up before you determine that they're actually dead after a hypothermic exposure.
So you're warming them and performing CPR then?
At the same time.
Okay.
Yeah. And you can warm them by getting them out of the snow and getting them into the back of your ambulance, taking their clothes off. I mean, those are all warming mechanisms. Okay. Back to local cold injuries. If a part becomes frozen, we call it frostbite. And how do we help our patients recover from frostbite?
One, you absolutely do not want to massage or rub the part.
Yeah, we're not going to rub it.
But you would want to warm it.
How are you going to want to warm it?
Slowly.
How?
Taking it out of the cold.
Taking it out of the cold. That's a good start.
I mean, you don't want to use like heating packs or anything like that because those are too hot.
Okay.
Maybe by your own touch.
You could maybe do it by your own touch as long as we're not rubbing on it, right? How else?
Using their own touch?
They could stick it in their armpits, right? Stick their hands in their armpits. That's a good way to do rewarming. Their body temperature isn't going to be so high that it causes damage to their cells, right? What else are we going to do?
Warm oxygen, humidified oxygen.
We can give them warm humidified oxygen.
Blankets.
Okay. What about our patient who has hypothermia? How are we going to warm them up? Not our frostbite patient anymore, but our patient who has systemic hypothermia. What are we going to do for them?
Same thing. Take them out of the cold.
Yeah, we need to remove them from the environment, get them out of their clothes.
And put them into a warm area, and then you also don't want to increase it too quickly.
Right. But an advanced EMT or a paramedic could use IV solution that's warm. It's not too hot, it's just not cold, right? They can use that. Okay. In most cases, when we manage our cold injuries or our cold emergencies, we want to get their wet clothing off of them. Whatever it is that's wet, get it off. Cover them up with a clean blanket. Turn the temperature up in your ambulance. You are going to be cooking because you're not suffering from hypothermia, so you're likely going to be sweating. But your patient needs that, you know, 110 degrees or whatever it is. I don't know. My car, when it gets to 80-something degrees, it feels like it's cooking. And I love it there. I leave it on high at the highest temperature for as long as I can. Yeah, she doesn't like it, but I do. And I turn my seat on and I leave my seat on all the time. My point in that little story was that you might not like the temperature in the back of the ambulance, but your patient who's suffering from hypothermia will. And it will help to warm their body temperature appropriately. Don't massage, don't let them have any stimulants. You can apply heat packs or hot water bottles to the groin and the axillary regions if they are only suffering from mild hypothermia. If they have moderate or severe hypothermia, you should not do any active rewarming. You can do some passive rewarming, which is like, you know, turning the temperature up in your ambulance. Questions about cold exposure? What you're gonna do in cold exposure? No?